Hi dear fans, friends and subscribers of Cricket Happenings. Welcome to this Sunday's Cricket Show with your host Ram. And well, let me tell you, the match at the Lord's Cricket Ground is absolutely set up right now, because England are ahead by 389 runs. Tomorrow is the final day here at the first test match at Lord's, which saw two centuries today. Yesterday it was Kumar Sanghakara getting his first ever century at the Lord's Cricket Ground, and that was a great feeling for Kumar Sanghakara. Today there were two more batsmen who etched their name into the Lord's books, and one was the Sri Lankan captain Angelo Matthews, who went on to make a century. And also later on in the day, what a way to actually reach a century for Gary Ballance. The final over of the day, Rangana had a tossed up the ball, Gary Ballance took the bait and dismissed him over mid-wicket for 6 to bring up his century. He was batting on 98 at that stage, and he hit a 6 to take England. hit a 6 on the final over of the day. I mean, that takes a lot of guts, because it could have been quite possible that the ball would have gone there and he might be out. But Gary Ballance, who was playing superbly, superb hand in that England close of play score of 267 for 8, hit a 6, and he was unbeaten towards the end. And as I said, tomorrow, the match is really, really set up. 389 runs on. It will be interesting to see. You know, if 390 is given, I think it would be a very realistic target. I don't think England should bat again, because Gary Ballance has already reached the century. But the only thing for India, England, would be they don't have any frontline spinners in the form of Graham Swan or Monty Panesar, who could have exploited this particular pitch to the hilt, because the ball is definitely turning. There is bounce. Everything is available. Well, Moeen Ali, whether he can create something out of the rough tomorrow, that is to be seen. So, but still, I think 390 runs is quite a target, which could be a real challenge for Sri Lanka. They might be tempted to chase that. As I said, England, only thing I think, they really, really lack a frontline spinner. So for me, that is the one which is the question mark. But still, I think Alistair Cook will declare the innings, because since Gary Ballance went on to his century in the final over of the day, that really tells me that definitely there is a declaration coming tomorrow in the morning when Alistair Cook would be, I think England would be fielding. And I think on the fifth and final day, Sri Lanka would be set a target of 390 on this particular pitch, and that is going to be pretty interesting. Well, so that is absolutely poised there. So now, and there is one more. And today the one-day international started between Bangladesh and India. As I said, Mushfiqur Rahim, the Bangladeshi captain, had said that India has actually sent an India A team. Well, let me tell you something. Mushfiqur Rahim would be the most disappointed man today, the Bangladesh captain, because even this India A team, even though the match was truncated due to rain, for 2 hours there was rain, but even 272 for 9, India were doing pretty well. The India openers, Robin Uthappa, who carried off his splendid form in the Indian Premier League, once again reeled off a 50 on his comeback to the Indian team. And also Ajinkya Rahane played a fine hand. And then rain actually came in, but that was not a real excuse, because what happened was, since the rain came, the match was actually reduced to 26 overs, but it put a bit of pressure on India, because the ball, because of the wetness and the pitch started drying up, as normally happens when there is wetness on the pitch and it starts drying up when the sun comes up. Definitely there is some assistance for the spinners, and that's what precisely happened, as the ball really, really started turning a lot, and there was a lot of bounce enabled. But looking at the target that India had, since the openers had done a fine job, in the end, I would say India definitely could go over the line with Suresh Raina, the captain, hitting the winning run, and India actually winning the first one-day international against Bangladesh in a rain-truncated affair by 7 wickets by the Duckworth-Lewis method, and now it would be the second one-day international. Well, I'll come back to that, but let's look at that match which I'm going to talk about, and that is between England and Sri Lanka on the fourth day. Looking at this fourth day's play, yesterday I told you in my Cricket Happening show on Saturday that Angelo Matthews has to stay there and he has to go. Well, one good thing that happened for Angelo Matthews is he went on to make a century. Even though he couldn't get much support, he really decided to play his strokes today, and he knew that he was running out of partners. and he reached his century. So Angelo Matthews getting on a century by actually carving Anderson for a boundary, and he got a century. He made 102 of with 12 boundaries. But as I said, Angelo Matthews couldn't get much support because first he lost Rangana Herath. Now the other thing about these English bowlers was that they were really bowling some body line stuff to the tail enders, with Rangana Herath really getting hit a couple of times, but then Anderson snuck a Yorker underneath the Herath's bat, and he was gone for two. After that, Angelo Matthews, well, he reached his century, but Angelo Matthews finally was dismissed when Plunkett had him LBW for 102 with 12 fours. For Angelo Matthews, this was his first century at the Lord's Cricket Ground, and what a proud feeling that would be for any test player. And after that, Shamin Dharanga was not on fine. Nuwan Pradeep, as I said, was also troubled by the pace bowlers. Jordan getting a short pitch delivery to him. Nuwan Pradeep, in the process of playing it, actually went and actually hit the stumps with his own bat, and he was adjudged hit wicket bowl Jordan for four. And finally, the innings ended with Shamin Dharanga not out on five, and Sri Lanka were all out for 453, and thus they conceded a lead of it was 122 runs lead was conceded by Sri Lanka to England. Looking at the bowling figures, Anderson had 3 for 93, 31 overs, 7 maidens. Broad had 29 overs, 8 maidens, 1 for 67. Jordan, 27.4 overs, 4 maidens, 102 runs and 3 wickets. Plunkett had 2 for 116 of 32 overs, 2 maidens, 16 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 56 for Moeen Ali. Joe Root bowled 3 overs, 1 maiden, none for 7. Now, as far as England were concerned, in fact, Sam Robson was pretty watchful outside his off stump. He was really choosing the balls to play. He hit two boundaries, and he was pretty sedate at that. Alistair Cook also in a similar manner, but I thought Alistair Cook was the one who was actually stroking the ball. He stroked a few boundaries of the bowling of Kulashekara and Nuwan Pradeep and Iranga, and then things were looking good. They were slowly chugging along, and they had added 46 runs by lunchtime, and everything was looking good for England with the overall lead of 122. But after lunch, Sharminda Iranga struck pretty quickly. First, he had the wicket of Alistair Cook, who actually played a bit loosely at a delivery, probably a bit stiff there after resuming after the lunch break. And immediately after lunch, Sri Lanka got a reward in the form of Alistair Cook, who was caught by Prasanna Jayawardene behind the sticks of the bowling of Iranga for 28 with 6 boundaries. And the second wicket to go, Sam Robson, as I said, was pretty watchful outside the off stump, and he was doing a pretty good job. But then Shamin Dharanga, who on the Lord's wicket, as you know, there is a slope which actually gets the ball to skid, and that's what precisely happened. Sam Robson was trying to drive a delivery, but Shamin Dharanga's pace was too quick, and also the Lord's slope made the ball really skid, and Sam Robson was a goner. Clean bowl by Shamin Dharanga for 19 with two boundaries. After that, Ian Bell came in. Well, Ian Bell, after hitting one boundary, fell in identical circumstances like Sam Robson. Again, the bowler was Shamin Dharanga. Shamin Dharanga took his third wicket by getting Ian Bell dismissed in similar circumstances, where the slope helped and also the ball skidded, and Ian Bell was gone. Clean bowl by Dharanga for 9 with 1-4. And suddenly England, who were 46 for no loss at lunch, were struggling after the triple strikes by Shamin Dharanga at the score on 69 for 3. And then after Shamin Dharanga had done the early damage, it was the turn of the spinner Rangana Herath to come in and do some damage too. So first, the score was pushed on to 98 with Gary Ballance coming in playing in a very defensive manner, and that was the order of the game at that particular time, with England in trouble. And Joe Root came into bat. Joe Root and Gary Ballance puts the score on to 98, but then Rangana Herath produced the delivery which turned, and Joe Root was gone. LBW bowled Herath, as he was actually hit on the back pad as he tried to sweep a delivery. He was hit on the back pad, up in the umpire's finger. Herath taking Joe Root, LBW for 15 with 2 fours, which made the score 98 for four. And after that, Moeen Ali came in to join Gary Ballance. Moeen Ali, the very first delivery that he received from Rangana Herath, he managed to, he actually came down the wicket and lofted it over Herath's head for a boundary. But the second delivery brought Moeen Ali's wicket, as Rangana Herath, what he did was pretty smart. He actually bowled a ball which turned, and Moeen Ali once again into the drive was really, really, I would say, I would have been really puzzled as the ball actually went through the gate of bat and pad and went on to hit the stumps. And Moeen Ali was walking back to the pavilion, bowled by Rangana Herath for four, and suddenly half of the England side were in the pavilion with the score on 102. Gary Ballance was watching it all at the other end as Matt Prior came in and started giving company to Gary Ballance. Gary Ballance also played some very, very good strokes, and as Matt Prior came in and joined Gary Ballance, suddenly Kulashekara was brought into the attack by the skipper Matthews. And Kulashekara, what he did is he picked up the wicket of Matt Prior by getting him in by, caught by 3 money for 16. And Chris Jordan, as he normally does, I mean, every time, you know, Chris Jordan comes to the crease, there is a sort of an anticipation, because he actually likes to get runs pretty quickly, and that's what he precisely did. It doesn't really matter what is the match situation, and Chris Jordan went on to actually attack the spinners. He hit a few boundaries, and he contributed a very good 35, and this partnership really, really helped, because from 121, you know, there was real acceleration at the particular stage. 78 runs were added for the 7th wicket in this partnership between Gary Ballance and Chris Jordan. Chris Jordan doing a lot of scoring, and also equally well was Gary Ballance, who was playing some very neat strokes. And finally, Rangana Herath picked up his 4th wicket. In fact, it was 3rd wicket, Rangana Herath, as Chris Jordan was dismissed, caught by Sangakkara of the bowling of Herath for 35 with 5 fours. And then Stuart Broad walked in, and Stuart Broad also started giving company. And Gary Ballance was really, really growing in confidence at that stage. But what was needed for Gary Ballance was some support. Well, Stuart Broad definitely did, but he could only make 24 runs with 3 boundaries before Rangana Herath caught him off his own bowling, and that sent Stuart Broad to the pavilion. And the score was 256 for 8 at that stage. And one was wondering, you know, how on earth Gary Ballance is going to get to his century. But well, Gary Ballance took his time. It was not so easy. Liam Plunkett came in to join him. Liam Plunkett was there at the crease. But then finally, Gary Ballance took his time. I mean, he was on 98, as I said, in the final over of the day. And Gary Ballance probably thought that, you know, looking at the score and the 5th day, final day coming up, probably getting some instructions that he has to get to his century today. Otherwise, tomorrow won't be the day. Probably England wouldn't be batting. And that's the precise reason Gary Ballance decided that in the final over, he is going to go for all broke. As what he did is, as I said, he dismissed Rangana Herath over the mid-wicket boundary for a 6 to bring up his century. And that too is maiden test century. And I would say now that Gary Ballance has done something which is of great note, because getting a maiden test century on a launch cricket ground, and that to a home batsman, I think that would give him much greater joy than Kumar Sangakkara and Angelo Matthews. But definitely Kumar Sangakkara, it was a maiden, it was the first century for him at the launch cricket ground, such a great player. But Gary Ballance, just on this infancy of his career, has got a maiden century on the Lord's cricket ground. And what a proud feeling that would be for Gary Ballance. And Gary Ballance, as I said, another future test prospect for England, definitely showed it here by actually holding the innings together. And he was the one who actually, with his not out 104, with 12 fours and 1 6, took this England score to 267 for 8. Thus, 389 runs ahead now England. And as far as the bowling figures were concerned, Kulashekara 15 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 65. Nuwan Pradeep 13 overs, 3 maidens, none for 37. But Kalashagan Pradeep, I thought, bowled well initially. But Shaminda Ranga, who did the early triple strikes, 18 overs, 7 maidens, 63 runs and 3 wickets. And then Rangana Herath carrying it forward 23 overs, 2 maidens, 95 runs and 4 wickets. And as I said, the match is really, really set up. I don't see any possibility of actually England batting tomorrow. I think we will be seeing Sri Lanka bat on the final day, and probably they'll be choosing 390 runs. And the reason that I'm telling this is because I think Gary Ballance getting a century in the last over of the day really tells me, because Gary Ballance was pretty quiet the entire time, but when it came to the last over, he hit a four. So that really gives me the feeling that I don't see any scope for Alistair Cook, the English captain, delaying the declaration. And that should be the way it should be. 380-90 runs, 2 wickets remaining, and stumps on day 4. That's the situation. So tomorrow, day 5, should be a pretty, pretty exciting one. Dear fans, friends and subscribers, don't miss it for the world. Well, let's get on from here into the India-Bangladesh one-day international series. As I said, it was the first one-day international. And as I said, Bangladesh were the ones who were under tremendous pressure yesterday in my preview. But today, well, Bangladesh were the ones who actually won the toss, and they elected to bat first. Well, they didn't have a good start. In fact, Umesh Yadav was bowling in tandem with Mohit Sharma, and Umesh Yadav, immediately reaped the rewards of some good bowling, as Tamim Iqbal was sent to the pavilion. Kotsaha bowled Yadav for a not. After that, it was Mominul Haq who came in, but Mominul Haq was also dismissed by Yadav. So Yadav picking up two important wickets to put Bangladesh in sort of a bother, because some probing deliveries, probing bowling from both the pace bowlers, Mohit Sharma and Umesh Yadav, really had the Bangladesh innings into a bit of a real struggle, and they were not really able to get runs. They only added 35 runs in the 10th over, and they also lost 2 wickets, with Umesh Yadav providing them the breakthrough pretty quickly. After that, one thing that I would like to say here in this particular match, we had debuts for two people. One was Akshar Patel, the left-arm spinner who did wonderfully well in the Indian Premier League 2014 and made a name for himself. And also, there was a debut for a person who really made history, and he is off-spinner Parvez Rasool, and he's from Jammu and Kashmir, and he became the first Jammu and Kashmir cricketer to ever play international cricket for India. And that was a proud feeling. And Parvez Rasool, he came in, and from 35 for 2, there was a bit of an acceleration as the captain Mushfiqur Rahim joined Anamul Haq, and both of them went about the task very well with Anamul Haq. And that was the time when Bangladesh, Suresh Raina, the Indian captain, decided to have the spinners into operation with Akshar Patel, Amit Mishra and Parvez Rasool bowling. And suddenly the runs started flowing because Mushfiqur Rahim was really playing some attacking strokes. And also Anamul Haq was using the slop sweep to good effect. He was reverse sweeping very well. And finally things were going for Bangladesh in the right way, and the score had actually gone on to 87, and that was the time Parvez Rasool was brought on, and in his very, very first over in international cricket, Parvez Rasool struck as he got Anamul Haq to go for a stroke which was a reverse sweep stroke, but in the end he had actually spooned the delivery. In fact, Anamul Haq actually tried to probably hoik him over mid-wicket, and Raidu took the catch, and Parvez Rasool was would have been very happy because that was his first maiden international wicket, and as I said, Parvez Rasool had made history as the first Jammu and Kashmir, first person from the state of Jammu and Kashmir to play international cricket. So Anamul Haq was gone 44 of 60 balls, 7 fours, and then briefly Mushfiqur Rahim, well, he made 59, and this wicket was also taken by Parvez Rasool for 59. After that, there were some contributions coming in. Shakib Al Hasan and Mahmudullah, they went into a very, very good partnership. With from 134, it was a pretty swift partnership, I thought, because runs started coming in with Shakib Al Hasan and Mahmudullah at the crease. Shakib Al Hasan's contribution was 52, caught and bowled Raina of 58 balls with 4 fours and 1 6. Mahmudullah chipped in with 41 of 44 balls with 6 fours. Nasir Hussain Mahmudullah actually playing down the wrong line to Mishra was clean bowled. Nasir Hussain was done in by a delivery from Mishra. He was gone for 22 of 20 balls with 4 fours. Ziaur Rahman could contribute only 2. And finally, it took Mashrafe Murtaza and Abdul Razak to pick up some quick runs towards the end, with Murtaza making 18. I'm sorry. of 10 balls with 2 fours and 1 6. And Abdul Razak was not out on 16 of 12 balls with 2 fours. And Bangladesh, thanks to some good batting coming at the final stages for Bangladesh, the Bangladesh score went on to 272 for 9 of the 50 overs. Looking at the bowling figures, Mohit Sharma, who hobbled off after bowling 5.4 overs, one maiden none for 23, didn't ever bowl. Umesh Yadav, I thought, bowled pretty well, but towards the death overs, I thought he got a bit of a tap. Umesh Yadav, 9 overs, no maiden, none for 3 for 48. Robin Uthappa bowled 2 overs to just fill in for Mohit Sharma to complete that over where Mohit Sharma hobbled off the field. Akshar Patel, I wouldn't say he was impressive. He was. They were really, really carted by both Mushfiqur Rahim and Anamul Haq. Akshar Patel, left-arm spinner, 10 overs, costing him 59 runs with 1 wicket on his one-day international debut. And I'm sure he's a quick learner, and he will quickly learn his lessons there. And then Amit Mishra, bowling 10 overs, no maiden, 2 for 55. And Parvez Rasool was taken for 60 runs in his first international match, but he took 2 wickets for 60 runs. Suresh Raina bowling 5 overs for 24 runs with a wicket to his name. 272 for 9 was considered a good score, considering India were not at full strength. But well, the openers, Ajinkya Rahane and Robin Uthappa, started off in a very nice manner. In fact, they played some very meaty strokes, especially Ajinkya Rahane. Ajinkya Rahane is a wonderful player. He hit a beautiful shot. He hit with some very nice sixes. In fact, Robin Uthappa continuing his fantastic form, also marking his return to international cricket in a wonderful way here, into one day internationals, into the Indian team, in a very wonderful way, by complementing, in the sense, by really, really combining well with Ajinkya Rahane, the other opener, and putting on 99 runs for the first wicket in 16.1 overs, is Robin Uthappa making the game, making the strokes that he looked, which was played with effortless ease, the way he used to hold his pose after, striking the bowlers for over long off for a six. He hit Shakib Al Hasan for a six. But what was good to see was that very good use of the feet to the spinners. And as I said, for Robin Uthappa, the cricket as a game is becoming uncomplicated, because he does it with absolutely little fuss. The way he actually maneuvers the strokes, initially, yes, he definitely had some trouble against Mashrafe Murtaza, but then once the spinners came, his confidence was really, really sky high. And Ajinkya Rahane also is another very good player of spin, and both of them punished the Bangladeshi spinners, and the score went on to 99, which was a pretty good start. And when Robin Uthappa, unfortunately, I thought that he was given out, probably Robin Uthappa thought that he had a bat onto it, but the umpire had already raised his finger, and Robin Uthappa, after on his comeback to the Indian team, went off in nice fashion after making 50 of 44 balls with 3 fours and 3 sixes, and Shakib Al Hasan was the wicket taker. And at that was the time the rain came in, in fact it rained for 2 hours, and the match had to be pruned, and finally the umpires decided that when play restarted, as I said, India were at a disadvantage because the ball was really, really turning. There was a lot of bounce because of the dryness of the pitch after the rain stopped. So that really put a sort of I wouldn't say it was much tougher, because India still needed 50 runs to win the match, 50-odd runs, and that too they had to do it in 26 overs. They need to get to a target of 150 in 26 overs, which was the revised target by the Duckworth-Lewis method. We saw the wicket of Cheteshwar Pujara falling pretty quickly after the resumption, as Cheteshwar Pujara was LBW bowled Shakib Al Hasan for a blob, and that made the score 100 for 2. And then after that, when the score reached 135, with Ajinkya Rahane, Ambati Raidu pushing the score to 135 in the 22nd over, there was still some job to be done, but Ajinkya Rahane was gone, caught very well by Ziaur Rahman of the bowling of Mashraf and Murtaza for 64 of 70 balls with 5 fours and 2 sixes. And at 135 for 3, Suresh Raina, the Indian captain, joined. Well, if you know Suresh Raina, what a bloke he is. And he really showed, he wasted no time there, stroking the ball sweetly and fluently. and picking up three boundaries in his unbeaten knock of 15 of 11 balls. And Ambati Raidu was not out on 16 of 19 balls or 2 fours. And, you know, India had to make 115 26 overs. In fact, with 9 balls to spare, they actually went on to the victory target by the Duckworth-Lewis method. 153 for 3 was the final tally for India, and India winning the first one-day international against Bangladesh by a margin of 7 wickets by the Duckworth-Lewis method, as I said, and also taking a 1-0 lead in the three-match series. Now, looking at the bowling figures, Murtaza 5 overs, 1 for 25. Al-Amin Hussain 5 overs for 32 was costly. Shakib Al-Hassan bowled 6 overs, 2 for 27. I thought he was the best bowler there. Abdul Razak 5 overs for 34. Ziaur Rahman bowled 1 over for 9 runs. Mahmudullah bowled 2.5 overs, no maiden, none for 26. Now, Jinkya Rahane from India was named man of the match. So, as I said, with 7 balls remaining, India winning the match by 7 wickets by the Duckworth-Lewis method. But that didn't really matter. As I said, for Mushfiqur Rahim the other day was telling that India has brought an India A team. Well, even in India not at full strength, I thought the Indian reserves have done a great job. One has to really, really commend the boys for their wonderful effort here. So keep it going, the Indian team. But Bangladesh, definitely you will have to really, really pull up something and see to it, because you know you're not playing a full strength Indian side, but you're playing a probably not even a half strength, I would say, because a lot of the big guys are missing, and I think Bangladesh have to really play out of the skins now to actually not only win the second one-day international, but also really prove a point to you know, go and win the third. Whether they are, as I said yesterday, India are not under pressure, but Bangladesh on their home ground are under immense pressure. And I'm sure the Bangladeshi public will be really, really waiting for Bangladesh to deliver. Well, I only hope that, you know, the matches get more interesting in the second and third one-day internationals, and may the best team win. Well, dear fans and subscribers, on this note, it's your host Ram winding up this very long cricket happening show this on a Sunday on 15th of June 2014. See you all tomorrow. Until then, it's goodbye from your host, Ram. Thank you.